Okay, super quick. I want to talk about subaudio and DC offset and why we don't want these in our audio files. First, let's make sure we're clear on what we're talking about. The range of human hearing in terms of frequency is from approximately 20 Hz to 20,000 Hz. 20 vibrations per second up to 20,000. So subaudio are vibrations that are below the range of human hearing, below about 20 Hz. So if we can't hear them, it doesn't matter if they're in our audio files, right? Well, you know that since I'm making a video, actually it does. Even if we can't hear them, they can cause us some trouble. So I want to look at some things in Audacity, but as usual, this concept matters in whatever software you're using. And it matters whether you're doing sample editing, synthesis, sound design, mixing, or even mastering. So here's a guitar riff we might have heard before. Okay, so what I'm gonna do is I'm gonna take this guitar riff and I'm gonna add subaudio in a silly way that hopefully you would never do, but let's give it a shot. I'm gonna generate a tone. And so let's make a sine wave at 8 Hz with an amplitude of 0.8. Hey, let's even go up to 0.9. Some really loud subaudio. Now the reason I'm doing a sine wave is a single frequency. If I were to do a different waveform like a square or a sawtooth, I would be adding harmonics too. And so in addition to that 8 Hz, I would be adding whole number multiples of 8 Hz, which would go into the audible range. So to keep this all in subaudio, sine wave just has the fundamental at 8 Hz, okay? All right, so we've added something in there. Let's zoom in just so we're clear on what's going on. Hey, there's our sine wave, right? We zoom back out of here and we'll listen. Let me solo that sine wave. So this is just the sine wave playing now, and we can't hear anything. We can see that the meter's all the way at the top, but because that's at 8 Hz, there's no sound. Okay, so we can't hear it, so no problem, right? Well, it's still in there, so let's export this as a wave. Guitar loop plus 8 Hz. Well, Hertz has an H in it. Bink. Mix down into a mono file. Okay. All right. Let's have a look at that. All right. So this looks a bit different than our original. I'm going to close out the sine wave there. So now this is just the original again. Let's zoom in a bit on the original. And now let's go over here and zoom in a bit on the new one. Hey, there's our sine wave. And what's it doing? It's taking the guitar sound that we can hear and then it's pushing it back and forth at 8 Hz. Now let's start thinking about the problems that that's causing. First, let me zoom back out and we'll listen. Original. Now, maybe you can hear the difference there, but it's not a difference of this 8 Hz one being more bassy. It's subtle, and again, after YouTube compression, who knows what we'll be hearing, but we've lost some fidelity here. And if you look at this waveform, you can start to think about why. Now, there are a few reasons here. Probably the least consequential one is we're no longer vibrating at the zero axis. So by moving out, we're vibrating up here and we've pushed, and down here, and we've pushed the speaker cone out. Again, I'm wearing headphones right now, but it doesn't matter. They're all loudspeakers. You've pushed the speaker cone out and that's trying to vibrate not at its ideal place, but a little bit further away. And this can cause some issues, but more significantly, we've greatly reduced the possible dynamic range of this sound. By pushing it off center, now we no longer have the full length of -1 to 1 to vibrate to. we only have this tiny amount of space. And guess what? Our guitar went over. And if you know anything about digital audio, you know that we've created clipping now. So we've created these patterns of clipping where the guitar is pushing outside of what we can represent digitally. Let's listen again. Original. Okay, so the first thing we can take away from this is don't add random subaudio sine waves. But you probably weren't doing that anyway. At least I hope. But there are other ways that this subaudio can get in there. It can come in at the recording stage, it can come in at your sound design stage, again if you're pitch shifting things down. And depending on what a plugin's doing, it might be adding this in your mixing process too. Here's a recorded sample that I'm suspicious might have subaudio. Now, it's not throughout the whole waveform here, but I can eyeball this and see two moments where the sound looks like it might be out of the range of hearing. One here, and one here. So now, how do I check on my suspicions? Well, we can figure out the frequency of a waveform from its wavelength. So I can take this, and let's say I'm being pretty loose here. I think this looks like one cycle, right? Up, down, and back. That looks like one cycle of that waveform. And I can look down here and see how long that cycle is taking. Again, this is the start position, and here I have length and end of selection here. So this is my length, 0.88 seconds. Okay. So hertz is the number of cycles per second. So we know that one cycle happens in 0.88 seconds, so how many times does 0.88, I keep saying 0.88, but I mean to say 0.088 seconds, how many times does 0.088 seconds happen in a second? 1 divided by 0.088 equals 11-ish, okay? 11-ish hertz, so that is definitely subaudio. Let's check out this other one. Zoom. This one's not quite as long. It's also a little bit not quite as sinusoidal. I think I need to move this over here a little bit more. Okay, so maybe that's a cycle. You can feel free to disagree with me, but okay. So now let's check that. Okay, that's not quite as long. So let's check this one out. 0.046, 1 divided by 0.046 equals 21 hertz. Okay, that's not quite subaudio. Now that said, probably most speakers and headphones aren't reproducing a sound at 21 hertz. And often in the mastering process, mastering engineers will filter out everything below 30 hertz, or sometimes even 40 hertz. I mean, we can try to do that. Command A, select all. High pass filter. Okay, let's roll this off pretty steeply. Let's keep it at 30, why not? Okay. Hey, there we go. So we can see we've eliminated this subaudio here, and we've changed our shape a little bit here. Again, this wasn't quite subaudio, but it looks like we flattened it out a bit. Okay, here's what it sounds like. Undo. Here's what it sounded like before. Redo. Undo. Okay, to me, those sound exactly the same, but that's okay, right? Because what we're trying to do is we're trying to remove things that are below the range of human hearing, subaudio. So that's good news that we can remove sounds that can cause us issues without affecting the sound that we want to hear. As I mentioned, this can be useful in the mixing process too, adding EQs with high-pass filters, and also in the final mastering process. Keep in mind that filters can, and often do, affect phase, and it can be useful to think about that before you go too overboard. Finally, I mentioned DC offset. DC offset is a little bit different, but it can cause us problems for the same reasons. DC offset is when the average of the overall waveform is off-center. So like if the waveform, instead of being centered around zero, is centered at 0.5 or even 0.2, right? Or negative 0.5 or negative 0.2. If the whole thing is offset, and once again, we're not vibrating around the zero axis, and we've reduced that dynamic range that's available. DC offset, you can get rid of in the same way with a high pass filter, or a lot of waveform editors have an algorithm to remove that. It's actually in the normalize function of Audacity, for example. Again, sub-audio is not helping your bass sounds, it's working against it. So if you can take care about sub-audio at every stage of your process, you'll actually find that your bass sounds become bigger and clearer.